Good morning. We come today to worship together, to be together here in this hall and across time and space. Welcome. We welcome you, whoever you are and whomever you love. We welcome you, whether you are extroverted or introverted, whether you need a hug or touch makes you nervous, or both at the same time. Whatever your gender, whether that changes or is always the same for you, and whether you know every song in the Taylor Swift catalog, the chorus of Autumn Leaves, or the B-sides of each Parliament Funkadelic record, we welcome you. I'm Matthew Johnson, the senior minister here at the church. My pronouns are he, him, his. Our worship team this morning also includes the Reverend Joyce Palmer, our assistant minister, Tim Anderson, our music director, along with the choir, and worship associate Bob Spellman. Autumn Powell, our office manager, is running tech for us today. Lindsay Trank, our director of religious education, has the day off. She gets one Sunday off each month. And our nursery staff this morning, both of them are sick. We have a very shallow depth chart when it comes to religious education. We pay a lead teacher for each room, and they are fantastic. And we have like one volunteer for each room. But if everybody's sick and school's back in session, and a lot of these folks are teachers or substitute teachers, and so they get sick, then we don't have anybody else. So we're talking about welcome today, and it's ironic that we had to close the nursery today. So parents are watching online or in the deal hall, or they welcome to bring their kids in here, but I think they chose online, because if you had two-year-olds, you might make that same choice. So we need your help. So if you'll advance the slide, this is really easy, but we can't just take anybody, right? We need to do a background check. We need two volunteers in a room, so it's not like we can just take somebody randomly on a Sunday. We have to plan for this. So you email Lindsay at reuurockford@gmail.com, easy to remember. Say, please send me an RE volunteer packet. We need folks who are not parents of young children to volunteer to help out to make this happen. Once a month, you get to know the kids, and then if we have a day where people are sick, then we have people who are trained and ready to do it. We can't. Right? So I need your help. If you are not a parent of young children but are comfortable around young children, or if you're comfortable around older children, we put you there and maybe we can move a volunteer around so that we might have a depth chart that goes one layer deeper, right? That would be enough to really make this work. We have great leaders, but sometimes things happen. So I need your help. I need you to volunteer for our religious education and just email Lindsay at reuurockford@gmail.com or see her next Sunday and let her know you need a packet. Fill it out. We do a background check. We have you work with somebody who's done it before the first couple times, and you're good to go. Okay? Thank you. If you are online this morning, hello, and you can go back one slide, Autumn, to the other one. Thank you. I put that in this morning. I'm like, we're going to get people. If you're online, hello, do like, comment, and share this worship service, and engage with others in the replies and comments. If you're in person, hello, masks are recommended but not required. The new booster is available. Make your appointment and get yours as soon as possible to keep us all safe. Do join us for coffee hour after the service. The noise of children is always welcome here, but please do silence your electronic devices. If today's your first day worshiping with us online or in person, we're very glad you're here. Let us know who you are at the guest table so we can be in touch. And before we begin, I invite you to turn to those around you and say hello. We're going to sing together our hymn of the month, Whoever You Are, and I invite you to rise in body or in spirit. Thank you.
I'm Bob Spellman, your worship associate for today. My pronouns are he, him, and his. We are worshiping in the homeland of the indigenous Ho-Chunk people and are humbled to be here on this sacred ground. This land, this country, this liberal faith, and our very lives are inherited from the complicated intersections of oppression, freedom, resistance, migration, war, justice making, and hope. From these legacies, we learn, grow, seek repair, give thanks, and build a better world for those who will inherit our choices. We gather today for worship, and as we gather, we join in our sacred ritual. The flaming chalice is the symbol of our faith, a beacon of truth, a fire for justice, a warmth for the soul. Leo today will light our chalice. Leo's 13, and he enjoys video games, and he's now as tall as his father. Let us speak together the covenant of our church. Love is the spirit of this church, and reason is its guide. To dwell together in peace, to seek truth and freedom, to serve human need, this is our covenant. And now let us sing together our chalice response song.
We gather and worship together. We begin with the prayers of the people, the naming of joy and sorrow, the holding in heart of those we love. We hold in our hearts all those recovering from illnesses and experiencing maladies of body or soul. May mercy and healing attend them. I invite you in this space to name those aloud or in silence who you are holding in your heart today.
Welcome is our theme this month, and we've talked about coats, taking off your coats and being welcome and feeling at home. And I said later we were going to talk about shoes. Today is shoes.
What I'd like you to do is place your feet on the ground if they reach and wiggle your toes. Feel the carpet and the floor through down to the basement below us and into the earth. Ground yourself in the earth. Feel it in your feet.
There are cultures where taking off your shoes is a sign of respect. In most of East Asia, you would never wear your outside shoes inside a home. And if you are doing, say, Tai Chi, feeling the earth is vital, a source of energy. You do this without shoes to get in the way. If you enter a mosque, you must remove your shoes, just as Moses took off his sandals in the presence of God.
And there are cultures where you would never take off your shoes or expect your guests to take off their shoes, where doing so would be considered very rude.
So I'm gonna leave my shoes on today, even though I have fun socks under here. But I'm also gonna wiggle my toes and feel the power of the earth, and I invite you to do the same. To be grounded here and now as we reflect together on what it means to welcome across and among our different ways of being together.
Welcome. Let us worship together. Our story today is Christopher Robin Throws a Pooh Bear Party. One day, when the sun had come back over the forest, bringing with it the scent of May, and all the streams of the forest were tinkling happily to find themselves their own pretty shape again, and the little pools lay dreaming of the life they had seen and the big things they had done. And in the warmth and quiet of the forest, the cuckoo was trying out his voice carefully and listening to see if he liked it. And the wood pigeons were complaining gently to themselves in their lazy, comfortable way that it was the other fellow's fault. But it didn't matter very much. On such a day as this, Christopher Robin whistled in a special way he had. An owl came flying out of the 100-acre wood to see what was wanted. "Owl," said Christopher Robin, "I'm going to give a party. And it's to be a special sort of party because it's because of what Pooh did when he did what he did to save Piglet from the flood. So will you tell Pooh as quickly as you can and all the others because it will be tomorrow." Owl tried to think of something very wise to say, but couldn't. So he flew off to tell the others, and the first person he told was Pooh. "Pooh," he said, "Christopher Robin is giving a party." "Oh," said Pooh, "will there be those little cake things with pink sugar icing?" Owl felt rather it was beneath him to talk about little things and little cakes with pink sugar icing. So he told Pooh exactly what Christopher Robin had said and flew off to Eeyore. "A party for me," thought Pooh to himself. "How grand!" And he began to wonder if all the other animals would know that it was a special Pooh party, and if Christopher Robin had told them about the floating bear and the brain of Pooh and all the wonderful ships he had invented and sailed on. And he began to think how awful it would be if everybody had forgotten about it and nobody quite knew what the party was for. And the more he thought like this, the more the party got muddled in his mind, like a dream when nothing goes right. And the dream began to sing itself over and over in his head until it became sort of a song. It was an anxious Pooh song.
The song.
"Three cheers for Pooh."
"For who?"
"For Pooh."
"Why, what did he do?"
"I thought you knew. He saved his friend from a wetting."
"He did?"
"Three cheers for Bear."
"For where?"
"For Bear. He couldn't swim, but he rescued him."
"He rescued who?"
"Oh, listen, do. I am talking of Pooh."
"Of who?"
"Of Pooh."
"I'm sorry, I keep forgetting. Who do you mean? Oh, Pooh. Pooh? Pooh who?"
"Well, Pooh was a bear of enormous brain."
"Just say it again."
"Of enormous brain."
"Of enormous what?"
"Well, he ate a lot, and I don't know if he could swim or not, but he managed to float on a sort of a boat."
"On a sort of a what?"
"Well, a sort of a pot. So now let's give him three hearty."
While this was going on inside him, Owl was talking to Eeyore. "Eeyore," said Owl, "Christopher Robin is giving a party."
"Very interesting," said Eeyore. "I suppose they will be sending me down with the odd bits which got trodden on." "Kind and thoughtful, not at all. Don't mention it."
"There is an invitation for you."
"What's that like?"
"An invitation.
Yes, I heard you. Who dropped it?
This isn't anything to eat. It's asking you to a party tomorrow.
Eeyore shook his head slowly. You mean Piglet, the little fellow with the excited ears. That's Piglet. I'll tell him.
No, no, said Owl, getting quite fussy. It's you.
Are you sure?
Of course I'm sure. Christopher Robin said, all of them. Tell all of them.
All of them except Eeyore.
All of them, said Owl huffily.
Ah, said Eeyore, a mistake, no doubt, but still I shall come. Only don't blame me if it rains.
But it didn't rain. Christopher Robin had made a long table out of some long pieces of wood, and they all sat around it. Christopher Robin sat at one end and Pooh at the other. And between them on one side were Owl and Eeyore and Piglet, and between them on the other side were Rabbit and Roo and Kanga. It was the first party to which Roo had ever been, and he was very excited. As soon as they sat down, he began to talk. "Hallo, Pooh," he squeaked. "Hallo, Roo," said Pooh. Roo jumped up and down in his seat for a little while and then began again. "Hallo, Piglet," he squeaked. Piglet waved a paw at him, being too busy to say anything. "Hallo, Eeyore," said Roo.
Eeyore nodded gloomily at him. "It will rain soon. You see if it doesn't."
Roo looked to see if it didn't, and it didn't. So he said, "Hallo, Owl." And Owl said, "Hallo, my fellow, my little fellow," in a kindly way. And Kanga said to Roo, "Drink your milk first, dear, and talk afterwards." So Roo, who was drinking his milk, tried to say he could do both at once. And he had to be patted on the back and dried for quite a long time afterwards. When they had nearly eaten enough, Christopher Robin banged on the table with his spoon. And everybody stopped talking and was very silent. "This party," said Christopher Robin, "is a party because of what someone did, and we all know who it was, and it's his party because of what he did, and I've got a present for him, and here it is." Then he felt about a little and whispered, "Where is it?" While he was looking, Eeyore coughed in an impressive way and began to speak.
"Friends," he said, "including oddments, it is a great pleasure, or perhaps I had better say it has been a great pleasure so far, to see you at my party. What I did was nothing. Any of you, except Rabbit and Owl and Kanga, would have done the same. Oh, and Pooh. My remarks do not, of course, apply to Piglet and Roo because they are too small. Any of you would have done the same, but it just happened to be me. It was not, I need hardly say, with an idea of getting what Chris Robin is looking for now," and he put his front leg to his mouth and said in a loud whisper, "Try under the table," "that I did what I did, but because I felt that we should all do what we can to help, I felt that we should all..."
"What's Eeyore talking about?" Piglet whispered to Pooh. "I don't know," said Pooh rather dolefully. "I thought this was your party." "I thought it was once, but I suppose it isn't." "Here it is," cried Christopher Robin excitedly. "Pass it down to Silly Pooh. It's for Pooh."
"For Pooh?"
"Of course it is. The best bear in all the world."
"I might have known. After all, one can't complain. I have my friends. Somebody spoke to me only yesterday. Always something going on."
Nobody was listening, for they were all saying, "Open it, Pooh." "What is it, Pooh?" "I know what it is." "No, you don't." And all other helpful remarks of this sort. And of course, Pooh was opening it as quickly as he could, but without cutting the string, because you never know when a bit of string might be useful. At last, it was undone. When Pooh saw what it was, he nearly fell down. He was so pleased. It was a special pencil case. There were pencils in it marked B for bear, and pencils marked HB for helping bear, and pencils marked BB for brave bear. There was a knife for sharpening the pencils, and India rubber for rubbing out anything which you might have misspelled, and a ruler for ruling lines for words to walk on, and inches marked on the ruler in case you wanted to know how many inches anything was, and blue pencils and red pencils and green pencils for saying something special in blue and red and green. And all these lovely things were in little pockets of their own in a special case, which shut with a click when you clicked it. And they were all for Pooh. Oh, said Pooh. Oh, Pooh, said everybody else. Thank you, growled Pooh. Later on, when they had all said goodbye and thank you to Christopher Robin, Pooh and Piglet walked home thoughtfully together in the golden evening, and for a long time, they were silent. When you wake up in the morning, Pooh, said Piglet at last, what's the first thing you say to yourself? What's for breakfast, said Pooh. What do you say, Piglet? I say, I wonder what's going to happen exciting today, said Piglet. Pooh nodded thoughtfully. It's the same thing, he said. Now let us sing the first verse of this little light of mine as the children, youth, staff, and volunteers head on to the religious education classes.
I hope you are subscribed to the Kairos, our weekly newsletter. Be sure to read it for announcements about upcoming events and activities. This week, I want to highlight that our auction is coming up this Saturday. The catalog is online. You can use the newsletter to look at what's in the catalog. And there is a lot of fantastic items, so thank you for your donations. It is Saturday, 5 to 7. I know the team is continuing to look for folks to help with setup and cleanup and to bring an appetizer to share with folks. An Oktoberfest theme one is great. I will say that last night, some of us were at the Rockford Promise Raise the Roof fundraiser. And at the end of the evening, they said, we bought too many cases of Oktoberfest from Prairie Street, and I hear that the auction at church is coming up. Do you want to pay us cost for them, and then you'll have it? And so I said, yes. So that's to look forward to on Saturday as well. So Saturday, 5 to 7, please come invite folks. We want to bid on those items to support our church. So I hope you will participate. Well, let's have a wonderful Wednesday. This Wednesday at 6 o'clock, Rebecca Benedict is going to be doing flower arranging, a beautiful practice that she is ready to share with you. But we do want folks to sign up so that we know how much supplies she needs to bring. And that link is also in the Friday update and in the newsletter to do so. Each month, we highlight the activities of one of our Faith in Action teams. For September, that's our Racial and Economic Justice team, and I want to invite Gloria to come up and tell you a little bit about what they're up to.
Hi, I'm Gloria Perez, along with Kathy Madison. I'm co-lead of the Racial and Economic Justice team. I don't know why that's hard for me to say. So what we want to talk about is that we meet on the second Sunday of every month after church. Today, after this service, we invite you to the reflections about today's service in the library. You're invited to the second part of the Anti-Racist Cookbook Workshop sponsored by Multicultural Ministries, Saturday, September 30th from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. This workshop will provide valuable tools in having cross-racial discussions to help build welcoming relationships with people around us. It's not necessary to have attended the first part, nor to have read the book. Come, learn about some ways to widen our welcoming practices. We now take up an offering to support the work of justice and mercy in the world. 80% of today's offering will go to Peace Building Connections, which was founded by Peace Builder.
Bob, and Bob is here. So wave if people have questions about this, see Bob afterwards.
There will be an International Declaration of Interdependence celebration at the Rockford University on Thursday, September 21st at 4 p.m. Thank you for your generosity. The offering will now be given and gratefully received.
A few weeks ago, the other new worship associates and I met with Matthew to discuss the next 4 months of Sunday service themes. He'd already penciled in the topic for each Sunday. I scanned them quickly, knowing that I'd have to give a testimony on one or two, but none jumped right out at me. Eventually, Matthew said to me, "Bob, why don't you take preemptive radical hospitality?" While my mouth said, "Okay," my brain said, "What? You don't even know what it means." But as has happened so many times to me in my life, whenever I was forced out of my comfort zone, I usually learned something. So I started by looking at each word individually. Preemptive means to go first, take the initiative. Radical, I worked on a little longer. I come up with other words like bold, bizarre, strange, out of the ordinary, but I finally settled on extreme. Hospitality is sort of a no-brainer. It means to be hospitable and welcoming. So we have go first, with extreme hospitality. UU calls it preemptive radical inclusion. And I'll read the definition for you. It is an adaptive set of perspectives and practices that people can use to increase justice and equity in their lives and organizations. It is more than just a philosophical approach. It is an intervention, an activity, a process that requires reflection and exploration and leads us to make decisions about what our next moves will be to involve everyone within those spaces where we have leadership responsibility. So what did I just say? Here's what I think it means to us here at UU. It means we to not be passive on who we might invite into our community. It means we need to change our tactics and think outside the box and be more radical or extreme in our efforts to be inclusive. We need to think of not only people we know, but people we do not know, strangers. We need to think of our friends, but also people we know but who we might not normally associate with. We all know people who we thought at one time or another would enjoy being a member here at UU, but for whatever reason, we've been reluctant to approach them. I myself fit into that category. But we need to push through those barriers and be creative in ways to approach them and invite them, as Matthew demonstrated on Sunday number one, with open arms. Last Saturday night, a week ago last night, my wife Linda and I were having dinner at our favorite restaurant when she asked me how my testimony was going. And I told her, well, I'd not really written anything down yet, but that I had been looking at the internet and I found some interesting articles and stories and such that I might use, and that I'd pretty much been formulating what I wanted to say in my head. And then it dawned on me, she probably doesn't even know what my topic is because we've never discussed it. So I asked her, what do you think preemptive radical hospitality means? And it took a little bit for the wheels to start turning, but she did what I did initially. She broke the three words down separately. And I deliberately held back from giving an opinion because I didn't want to steer her in any particular direction. But it wasn't long before we were off and running. I could tell by the excitement in her eyes that she was really getting into this. And for the next 20 or 30 minutes, we had a very enjoyable discussion. And she gave me some good ideas. The next day, last Sunday, we continued to discuss things as they popped into our head throughout the day. The next day after that, last Monday, was the day after the dreaded Packers beat my Bears, more like clobbered my Bears. I was sitting in the kitchen and she walked in. To say that she burst into the room is a little strong, but she entered with some purpose. And she said to me, Bob, preemptive radical hospitality would be like you inviting your Packer buddies over for lunch, and then you spending the entire lunchtime discussing how wonderfully the Packers played yesterday. She had me. But now that I know that preemptive radical hospitality is part of our faith, following through with her suggestion is going to be a real test of my faith. Thank you.
And I love you all, too. I thought I had some walking time there. I thought you were going to introduce it. Otherwise, I would have been here ready to go. You know, we know this one. And if you don't know this one, you are shortly going to know this one. We'll sing it as a round, so we will divide up. So this side will be part one. And Jan, raise your hand. Jan's row and forward will be group two, and behind Jan will be group three, and the choir is going to be group four. We'll sing through all the way together once to make sure we know it. Then, once we start the round, you'll sing through two times, and I'll bring you in. And then at the very end, we'll all repeat that last line, come yet again, come, until everyone is singing the same thing. So if you would rise in body and or in spirit, We'll sing all together once, and then we'll start the round. Here we go. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, ours is no caravan of despair. Come, yet again come.
Good morning. My name is Carol Hunter. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I would like for you to a moment imagine when you came through those doors this morning, it was your very first time here. And there was no one came up to greet you. And everybody's standing around talking with the people they know. And there was no welcoming table where you got a welcome name tag and you just kind of hung out there and didn't know what to do. That's what it was like for people back in the day before Matthew came and right after Dave Weisbard retired. We had an interim minister, Howell Lind, and Teresa Wilmot and I were new members of the membership committee and co-chairing it. And we didn't know a lot about, you know, what had been done in the past and what we should be doing. But Howell took me aside one evening and said, you know, this is a very unwelcoming church. And I was taken aback because it didn't feel unwelcoming to me. But he took me down the hall to the front doors and said, imagine coming through here and nobody talks to you. And there's all this milling and friendly talk going on, but not to you. So he made suggestions that we have greeters and a welcoming table where you could get a name tag and people would talk to you about how to become involved in the church and give you whatever, you know, tell you about Kairos. And we put that into practice. We also made these name tags, and we had name buttons at the time, but they were about this big and you had to kind of lean into somebody's chest to see what their name was. And so we made these and encouraged members to wear them to be more welcoming. So, I forgot what I was going to say. I didn't write it down. So anyway, I understood that on an intellectual level, you know, the things he was suggesting, I kind of got it. But I didn't really get it on a gut level until my husband and I visited a church, I don't remember where it was, maybe it was in New York, and we walked in and everybody was milling around and talking and we kind of went, where do we go, where's the order of service, and then I got it. It's just like, nobody came up to us. We didn't know anything until we figured out which door to walk through when we got our order of service. So If you came here this morning for the very first time, or it's been 50 years since you've been coming, when you come through those big doors, I hope you felt welcomed.
Thank you, Carol. I asked Carol to tell that story today because I think it's important for folks to know where we've come from and what we've learned. One reading this morning, a poem from the poet William Stafford called A Tentative Welcome to Readers. It is my hope that those who blame these tentatives may find some other reading and be supremely matched by pieces worthy of them. I offer these I've found, no claims except their being mine. A glance may serve. Do these belong inside your life? My life, reader, encountered these trance-like events that I've turned into things to tell. If you like them, fine. If not, farewell. And I invite you to join me in the spirit of prayer and reflection. Wiggle your toes. Feel the power of the earth beneath you. Spirit of life and love, wondrous power of many names. Cultivate in us the gift of curiosity and open-heartedness. To see the other before us, a reflection of the divine, unique and themselves. To be open-hearted to the new and the possible, and to be tender and kind to one another and to ourselves, that we might be curious and open-hearted about our own heart, our own self as well. Let us all be held in the embrace of a love larger than our naming and our knowing, this day and every day. Amen. Christopher Robin throws a party for Pooh, that silly old bear. Why? Because Pooh saved Piglet in the flood. So, a party. And everyone is invited, everyone except Eeyore? No, everyone, Eeyore included. Now let us imagine. Let us play out the story a little bit, do a little midrash on Winnie the Pooh. And we are not the first. The Tao of Pooh did this years ago, so we're in good tradition here. What if everyone showed up to the party and the table only sat four? Christopher Robin, Pooh, maybe Piglet and Rabbit. But Kanga and Roo don't get a seat, neither does Eeyore or Owl. Or what if they showed up for the party and Christopher Robin only had lunch meat to serve, even though Rabbit is a vegetarian, and only wheat bread, even though Kanga is gluten-free, and only peanuts had peanuts on the table, even though Roo is allergic? Right? Preemptive radical inclusion is a practice, a habit of learning in advance what will produce a feeling of inclusion, of belonging and worth, and taking steps to make that more real. And it is particularly interested to make sure that those often overlooked or excluded are centered and included. So you begin by asking, what do folks who are often not here need in order to feel that they belong at this place? Preemptive radical inclusion, a concept articulated among Unitarian Universalists by the religious educator C.B. Beale, is not an outcome, but as C.B. says, it is a doorway to justice. By taking actions which advance, which center the needs of those marginalized, you move toward the beloved community. You respect the dignity and worth of each person. You indicate that the guest matters if you are the host. You show that the person you're in conversation with matters when you're talking to someone. And when you are included in this way, you feel seen and valued. In a world in which so much is transactional or defensive, preemptive radical inclusion is a counterweight to dehumanization, an invitation to curiosity and learning. It does require more time, that's for sure, and more effort. Christopher Robin needs to think about his guests. He needs to either ask or already know their needs, and he would already know because he had already asked. And he needs to be ready to clearly communicate what will be available. This is part of inclusion, too. We're serving the little cakes with the strawberry icing, and we have lemonade. For example, he might say, and then Kanga would know to bring some milk for Roo if she wants. The party starts at this time. It's in this place. You are welcome. So on and so forth. And because Christopher Robin cares about his friends, he would make sure that they, each of them got what they needed in order to be present. Preemptive radical inclusion is a habit of welcome, a deeper welcome, a way of shifting day by day over time the culture and practices of a place to make it better to meet the mission and purpose. It really is about putting love into practice. If justice is what love looks like in public, then inclusion is what love looks like among a group of people. How beautiful the translation of the anthem goes this morning, how beautiful it is to live in order to love. Giving of oneself is loving, that this is part of the purpose of life, is to welcome one another into our lives and to be welcomed. Preemptive radical inclusion is a way of putting the golden rule into practice, or what we sometimes call the platinum rule, actually, not treating others as you wish to be treated, but treating them as they wish to be treated at their best, because everyone has different needs. And this is the critical thing about preemptive radical inclusion, that we have different needs to be present. So if I build something that's welcoming for me, that will be welcoming for people like me, but it might not be welcoming for people who are not like me. Some of us need to have a flat surface that we can navigate. Some of us need amplification of sound so that we can hear. Some of us have restrictions on what we can eat. Some of us need to have a translation of the language in order to be present. Some of us need childcare, though others need the opportunity to have their child with them. There are other practices which makes folks feel welcome and included. Greeting people is one of those. This is what Carol was discussing, and how important it is for you to put yourself in the position of a newcomer and see things and feel things with new ways. When you experience something with newness, you see the gaps in welcome. But it's so hard to do because we get so used to what is, we don't even notice. But it's not just about greeting people, it's also about greeting people well. Which means that radical inclusion means calling people by their correct name and using pronouns that they tell you to use. That's part of preemptive radical inclusion, and learning about that in advance so you're ready to do that well. It means noticing people as they are and not stereotyping people or making assumptions about them. It means being curious, but not an inquisitor. Do you understand the difference between those two things? It's important. Letting folks set their own pace about self-disclosure and how much they want to tell you about their life. It's knowing that sometimes folks take their shoes off and sometimes they keep them on. It is a habit and a practice and a journey. You don't ever get it right. It's not about arriving. It's about a habit. It's continuing to be on the journey, working to get it better. You keep learning. Preemptive radical inclusion is something that institutions can work on. It's also something you can do interpersonally. A one-on-one conversation with a friend or a child or a lover or a neighbor, even someone you've known for years, can be imbued with this spirit. What would make them more welcome? Lead with curiosity instead of judgment. Wonder, ask. And it's something you can do with yourself, with your own heart. I love this idea to be inclusive and welcoming to yourself, to treat yourself, your feelings, and your being with curiosity and kindness, to do the things that make you feel welcome in the world for yourself. It's a beautiful thing to sing, come, come, whoever you are, wander, worshiper, we welcome you, whoever you are, whomever you love, wherever you come from. It is beautiful and lovely. And I could stop there and call it good, and I would be derelict in my duty to tell the truth in love and to take this question seriously. Because though a lot of inclusion work is very clear and obvious, and we should do it and can do it, there's a lot we can all get behind and make a lot of progress on. Calling folks by their true name, seeing the humanity in each other, making sure there are options for those who need them as much as we can, all that is easy. But past that, it gets complicated in a hurry, in a big hurry. And it isn't always simple. And I don't want to mislead you by telling you that it is. So some slightly complicated parts that take extra effort, but are definitely doable if you do some extra effort most of the time. Like, what do I do when folks need different things to feel welcome? Some folks need to be able to take notes on their phones in order to pay attention. Others find that so distracting to see someone else on their phone that they can't pay attention. What do you do then? Some folks are on keto diets and some are vegans, and you're having a dinner party. What do you do then? Some folks need high energy to feel like they belong to something, and some folks need chill and quiet. Humans are complicated, and this stuff isn't always easy to figure out. You offer options when you can. You admit that you can't do it all. The larger the organization, the more they should be able to do, but not everything is possible all of the time. That's just real, and you can't meet everyone's need 100% of the time. You just can't, not when there's more than one person in the room, and sometimes even then, we can't meet all of our own needs all the time, can we? Sometimes I want two different things at the same time, and I bet you do too. So that part isn't easy. But there are other parts that are even harder. Christopher Robin throws a party for Pooh. But Eeyore, dear sweet Eeyore, he gets confused. He starts giving an acceptance speech. Now, maybe this is where Kanye got the idea to interrupt Taylor Swift from seeing Eeyore do it to Pooh. It's a joke only some of you will get, but I'm okay with that. One version of inclusion would say, this is what Eeyore needs, so he gets to do that. But I think that's wrong. It isn't Eeyore's party. And the group makes it clear, they just stop paying attention to him, they go on with it, doing, no, Eeyore, this isn't about you. You are welcome here. You are not excluded from the invitation. Everyone, including Eeyore, is invited. But he doesn't get to change the purpose of the gathering to something that it isn't about. I have seen the concept of we welcome everyone to be weaponized by bullies, harassers, narcissists, malcontents, and emotional vampires. Every minister I know in Unitarian Universalism has seen it too, and in some other traditions as well. Because we emphasize our welcome, the width of our embrace, we don't require a creed, every kind of person is welcome here. Because we say we want to be inclusive, that's a goal we're working towards, folks take it to mean that there are no boundaries on behavior. Folks will be cruel and abusive and insulting, and then when you withdraw from the connection, set a boundary, say, no, you can't act like that, they'll scream about free speech or say that you're the cruel one. How dare you not let them do whatever they want, even if that action is harmful to others. Now, this doesn't just happen among religious communities. It happens in the public sphere. You see it all the time. People are cruel on cable news or on the comment section. If you say, don't be mean, they say, what, you can't handle free speech. Right? And it happens in interpersonal relationships, including between family members and friends and between supposed lovers. So I want to be very clear. Preemptive radical inclusion does not mean a lack of boundaries around behavior. It means lowering the boundaries or eliminating them around identity, but not around behavior. Whether that's interpersonal or in community, setting boundaries about behavior is actually required for genuine inclusion. If you came to Christopher Robin's party and Eeyore talked the whole time and no one set a limit, would Pooh feel welcome? Isn't he also at that table? Would anybody feel welcome? What if a guest came who started insulting everyone, started throwing cake at people's faces? You can't allow that and have community. This is why I said earlier that preemptive radical inclusion is a way of learning and growing that helps a group meet their mission. It means that you work to reduce or eliminate barriers to participation on the basis of assumptions, culture, habits, and practices which are not relevant to your mission. And one thing that gets tricky here is that sometimes we mistake differences in culture for differences of behavior, right? So that takes learning and education, and we can get better at that. Preemptive radical inclusion is about investigating, are we being inclusive? Are we planning for guests who might be different than us? And what is critical? What is the boundary we do want to set? And what are the boundaries we don't want to set, but we are setting unintentionally or because we haven't thought about it? You see the difference between those things? And the other question is, are we willing to be changed by the other person, by one another? Because inclusion is a doorway. It does not substitute for mission itself. It's about making sure that all those who want to be part of the mission and can return again and again to the covenant are included. And that's why I included that beautiful short little poem from William Stafford, A Tentative Welcome to Readers. The reader is welcomed to read these poems, to find these poems in their life. And if you find them meaningful, fine. If not, the poet says, farewell. In ministry, we call this self-differentiation. You can practice self-differentiation in your own life, too. It is a good thing. Inclusion is a doorway. Remember. So welcome does not mean not having boundaries. There's one more complication I want to lift up, that while we should eliminate barriers to entry based on identity, disability, and so forth, there's also something to be said for doing the work to be new to something and the growth that happens when we face a challenge. I mentioned Taylor Swift earlier, and some of you recognized the tune or saw in the order of service that Tim played Welcome to New York, a song of Taylor Swift's, for the offering, and I want to thank him for humoring me again this week. And if you know that song, then you know that the refrain is, welcome to New York, we've been waiting for you. Welcome to New York, we've been waiting for you. We've been waiting for you. And that gets at the spirit of preemptive radical inclusion. We've been waiting for you. We've set a place for you. You are welcome here. And whether you are the guest or the host or a bit of both, considering what it means to be welcomed in this way is holy work, and it's life-affirming work, and it's good. And yet the backstory to the song helpfully complicates things. When she first moved to New York from Nashville, deciding to be a pop star instead of a country star and starting over in a certain sense in her life, she didn't think she was cool enough. The city was too much and overwhelming. And the fact that Taylor Swift didn't think she was cool enough is reassuring to the rest of us. At least it is reassuring to me. But found that by digging in and reaching past her comfort zone, it was waiting for her. Not as she was, but as she was becoming. Or as that other song about New York goes, which some of you will know, if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. Sinatra's song has that same spirit as Taylor Swift's song. Here you can test yourself, prove yourself, become yourself. And I want to take New York and both these songs as metaphors, not just as actual place, of doing the hard thing, of becoming. Because welcome changes us. Real welcome does, at least it should. It doesn't leave us where we are. Whether we're the one who does the welcome or we're the one who is welcomed, and really isn't it always some of both whenever we encounter another person? Aren't we doing both? It doesn't leave us who we are. For those two singer-songwriters, if New York was easy, it would not be worth the becoming. It was good because it was hard. If community welcomes us just as we are and doesn't invite us into a journey of becoming, then what, frankly, is the point? We've been waiting for you. Hopefully, we've prepared as best we can to make that welcome genuine and loving. And to come to this party isn't just to get cake and lemonade, but to join in something larger than yourself, a learning and growing people who pledge ourselves anew, who would be one in living for each other, not for ourselves alone, but also not forgetting ourselves either, or our dignity, or self-respect, to show the world a new community. We've been waiting for you, and we hope you will join in building a nobler world, and that together we'll learn and grow and care for each other as we are and as we are becoming. There's a party. Come, wanderer worshiper. There's a place for you. Not at the margins, not necessarily at the center either, but one among many. There's a party. And you, yes, you are invited. Pull up a chair, roll up a chair, and be welcome here. Be changed here. Become here. We're going to sing together. I invite you to rise in body or spirit. We would be one.
Thank you.
Bob will extinguish our chalice, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. Yeah, come on, let's extinguish the chalice. We hold these together until we've carried these with us until we are together again. While they do that, I invite you to join hands for our benedictions. If you'd rather not be touched, place your hands in your pockets or on your shoulders. When I think about inclusion, I think about the universalist message that God's love was so large that no one would be excluded, that heaven, the beloved community, was for everyone. And some people said to the universalist, does that mean you don't have to be a good person because God loves you no matter what? And they said, of course not. Because you are loved, because you are included, you love others and be a good person and begin again and again and again. So the words for our benediction from one of the founders of universalism in America, Hosea Ballou, who said, if we agree in love, there is no disagreement that can do us any injury. But if we do not, then no other agreement can do us any good. Let us endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. We'll sing together our sung blessing.